thank you for tuning in to another week of Heal and Emerge Weekly Bible Reading. Over the next few weeks, we will be picking up our study with Matthew chapter number 19. During our last couple of weeks, we looked at Matthew chapter 18, and we chose as a title for that series of readings, No Conversion, No Entrance. And we got that topic straight out of the scripture. And usually that's what we try to do in Matthew chapter 19 when you learn what our topic is going to be for this set of scriptures or this chapter. It's going to come straight from the scriptures. When we talked about no conversion, no entrance for Matthew chapter number 18, our first week message was woe to the offender. And we looked at verses 1 through 9 of that chapter. For the second week, we chose for a topic, you were not born to perish. And we looked at verses number 10 through 14. For our third week, we chose the topic, forgive your way to freedom. And we looked at verses 15 through 22. And for our last week for that series of messages, we chose for a topic, wicked, wretched, and tortured. And we concluded that chapter looking at verses number 23 through 35. As we pick up our study with Matthew chapter 19, we are going to use as our topic for this series, He healed them there. He healed them there. He being Jesus, healed them there. And we are going to, for our first week, cover verses 1 through 10 of Matthew chapter number 19. And our weekly topic is going to be, did God join you together? We'll say that. Did God join you together? Did God join you together? We're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 19, verse number 1 through 10. As we always do, before we even delve into the scripture, we look at our foundation scripture that we've been reading since we started doing these teachings years ago. Isaiah chapter number 55 is what we always start off with, because we want to make sure that as we are reading this word, that we are not trying to bend what God is saying to fit what's comfortable for us. We want to be uncomfortable if it means getting us closer to God. We don't want to be comfortable in our wrong ways, in our wretchedness. And that's the word we're going to look at. We're going to look at wretched this week. So I may use it a little bit more than I would normally use it, which I think I just used it in the last set of messages for the last week of the last series. But I'm going to be using wretched quite a bit over the next couple of weeks, because that's what we're focusing on. What does it mean to be wretched? And how does it plug into how we behave, how God sees us. That's a good way of saying it. How does it relate to how God sees us when we don't make an effort to align with His will and His way? So let's go ahead and read Isaiah 55, which is what we do to make sure that we are putting in the effort to be in alignment with God. We want to make sure that we are accomplishing that. I want to start with verse number 6 and read through verse number 11. And it reads, this is Isaiah 55, verse 6, and we're going to read all the way through verse 11. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing which I sent it. God's ways, God's thoughts are higher. If God puts something in motion, it will accomplish what he pleases, and it will prosper in the thing which he sent it. No matter how things feel, no matter how much your emotions try to tell you that this is the most horrible and that this is terrible, if you align your thoughts and your ways with God, it will work together for the good of those who love him. It will. And his word will not return void. And we have to believe that. We have to believe that no matter how much the enemy tries to show us how big and bad he is, no matter how much he stands in our face and huff and puff and maybe even blow our natural houses down, that God has the final say, that his word will not return to him void, that it will prosper in the thing that he sent it, that it will accomplish what he set it out to accomplish. And that is not a possibility, that's a fact. And we have to stand on that and believe that. The time is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And victory is not according to the natural. Victory is according to the spirit. And the battle is already over. Jesus settled that on the cross. So whatever it is we are living through or journeying through right now, we've already won when we align ourselves with God. That's why it's important for me in starting these messages to make sure that I'm saying, Lord, Father God, who art in heaven, decrease anything that you created that would try to compete with the knowledge of the Creator. Decrease it. Kill it. So that the alignment, the empowerment, the anointing, the power can be experienced from on high. In Jesus' name. Amen. And we always go to Matthew chapter 6, and that's where we get our prayer from every week as well, for the same reasons that I just mentioned. We want to make sure that we are honoring our Creator, that we are letting Him know that we reverence Him, that we hallow His name, that He is the Almighty, and that we do submit ourselves, yield ourselves, reduce ourselves, die to ourselves, that we turn our life over to Him, for Him to use us to the highest of His abilities, that we are willing vessels to bring heaven to earth, that we want to be conduits, we want to be facilitators of the gospel, the good news. We want that. And so we want to make sure that we are tapping into the scriptures that makes Him aware of that, so that He knows that if He needs to use somebody, that we are available for that, and that we are completely yielded to His will and His way. We look at the way that Jesus told the disciples to pray in Matthew chapter 6, starting at verse number 9. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We hallow your name. We want your kingdom to come. We want your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. We want to be a partner with you in making that happen. And we'll forgive who we have to forgive. And we ask that you forgive us. Lead us in a way that gets us closer to you. That helps us to be able to be used more by you. We want to be used. We want to be like Peter. We want people to be healed in our shadow. Not so that we can get the glory, but so that you can get the glory. We want that. In Jesus' name, amen. And so now we're going to go to our scripture reading, Matthew chapter number 19. And remember, our topic for the month is He healed them there. He healed them there. Also remember that I said we're going to focus on the word wretched, because we're pulling that from our last week topic, wicked, wretched, and tortured. And in order to get a better idea about how the Bible views wretched, we're going to go to Revelations chapter number 3. And we are going to look at verses number 14 through 22. Revelations chapter 3. Verses 14 through 22. And it says, "And the angel of the church, and to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans, write, these things says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come to him and dine with him, and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So far the scripture, and that is Jesus speaking to the church of the Laodiceans. And in verse number 17 is where he said, because you say, now this is like what he's saying, what you say and what he says to what they say is that you wretched. But let's read it how he said it. He said, because you say I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched. You're miserable, you're poor, you're blind, and you're naked. And he's saying, I counsel you to buy from me gold. So he's saying the gold that he has, it can't be reproduced on earth. The riches that he has will give you everlasting life. You'll live on forever with this gold that he's trying to sell you, your life. But in order for you to get this life, you have to lose your life. You have to give it up. And it's just a matter of the will. It's an act of the will. It might mean that you don't give up anything because he sees that your heart is right. An example of that is Abraham, when he told Abraham to make for himself a sacrifice. So he wanted him to sacrifice Isaac. And he just wanted to see what Abraham's will was. And Abraham was like, I'll give it up. The son that you promised me, that you gave me, if you want him, I'll give him to you. But God just wanted to know what was his heart. What was his will? Did he have a heart after God? Or did he have a heart after the things of the world? The things that God had blessed and can and could bless him with. And when he went all the way through to doing it, he said, oh, hold up now, Abraham. Now I know I can trust you. So in here, when he's saying, take this gold that I have, you know, you're saying you have need of nothing, that you're rich, that you're wealthy. But I'm telling you, you're wretched, because that's where your validation is in all of these things that you have. That's how you measure yourself, because of these things that you have. And those things mean nothing compared to this gold that I can offer you, that I have offered you when I died on the cross. So when he says wretched, he's saying that if you are not chasing after this gold, no matter how rich and how important and how wealthy you think you are, you're poor, you're blind, you're naked, you're miserable, you're wretched. You're wretched. And so when we talked the last week, we talked about wicked, wretched, and tortured, because he tortured the wicked. Wretched was something that I inserted because he led me to do that, but I did not know that he would pick back up with wretched in the next series of messages. So he wants us focused on wretched and how he sees wretched. And here in Revelation chapter number 3, verses 14 through 22, where he's talking to the lukewarm church, he's saying, I wish you were hot or cold. I can deal with that. At least I know what I'm dealing with. But you lukewarm. That's double-minded, unstable in all your ways, wretched. So as we go into this next couple of weeks, this series, he healed them there. I do want to kind of keep the focus on wretched whenever it's applicable. And we'll discover that as we go through the series of messages. For now, let's go ahead and read Matthew chapter number 19. And I said we're going to cover verses number 1 through 10. So let's read and see what the Lord is saying. Here beginneth the reading of God's word. Matthew chapter 19, verse number 1. Now it came to pass when Jesus had finished these sayings, that he departed from Galilee and came to the region of Judea beyond the Jordan. And great multitudes followed him, and he healed them there. That's where we get our topic. And he healed them there. Verse number 3. The Pharisees also came to him, testing him and saying to him, "It is lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason." That's a question. Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason? And he answered and said to them, "Have you not read that he who made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, 'For this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh?' So then they are no longer two but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate." Then they said to him, "Why then did Moses command to give a certificate of divorce and to put her away?" He said to them, "Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, permitted you to divorce your wives. But from the beginning, it was not so. And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and marries another, commits adultery. And whoever marries her who is divorced commits adultery." His disciples said to him, "If such is the case of the man with his wife, it is better not to marry." So far, the scripture. So this is what the disciples are saying. They're saying, well, it's better not to marry then, because if being married means you can't get a divorce, think about this. If being married means you can't get a divorce, if you change your mind and say, God told me to do this, but now he's telling me to do something else. If they're saying, if we can't have that type of thought process, then it's better to just not marry at all. Because Jesus is saying here that God never meant, if God puts you together, for you to get divorced. And you got to think about it in terms of Christ being the church, the bride. We're the bride and he's the church, and we're supposed to be joined together with him. That was the whole purpose of him giving his life for us, so that we could be joined back to God the way that we were meant to be before the garden situation happened. Our topic for this week is, did God join you together? Did God join you together? Did God join you together? If God joined you together, verse number 6 says, "So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate." did God join you together in these relationships, in and out of different types of relationships and religions? That if you say, I believe, I confess my sins, I believe that Christ, Jesus Christ, is Lord, and that God sent him to be the Savior of the world, and I lay my life down and I invite him in, and I turn right and I keep straight, and I'm living for God, I want to be rejoined back to my Father who was in heaven. I want to be one with him. I want to be one flesh. I want to be one with him. Then a couple of weeks, years, whatever later, you shouldn't be joining with some other type of faith. Because there's one God, one faith, one baptism. So the same way that Jesus is talking about marriage here, therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate. If God joined you together, and then you leave who you say God joined you with and you join another, he says in verse number 9 that you commit adultery. And you just put adultery out there, because whoever marries her who was divorced commits adultery. It's like you just mess up things. God, you can't be prostituting yourself to different gods and say that you're a kingdom representative. You can't be prostituting yourself to different faiths and say that I am called by God to be judge, jury, and executioner. You can't be prostituting yourself around with different faiths and different gods and say I am qualified to lead anybody, anywhere, and anything. And you can't speak for God when your actions and everything that you're doing is contrary to what his word says. You can't say that you have faith and that you're joined to God and everything about you is contradictory. You can't say that you have faith and that you're joined to God and you're supporting evil. You're facilitating evil. You're doing evil unto the least of these. You're doing evil in order to elevate yourself. Did God join you to him? Did God join you together with him? Or did you join yourself to him as it is convenient for you? Are you one that he's going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you? Did God join you together with him? Did you really give your life to him, lay down your life, and pick up your cross and follow Christ? Did God join you together with him, or did you do that? And when it's convenient for you, you undo that. Did God join you together with him? The good news to all of this is our monthly topic, or our series topic. And it comes from verse number 2. And the great multitudes followed him, followed Jesus, and he healed them there. It's never too late to turn right and keep straight, to accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, to follow him and let him heal you right there where you make that confession, right there where you turn right and keep straight, right there where you decide to decrease so that he can increase in you. If you do not know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, invite him into your heart today and he will heal you right there. And until next week, be blessed.